You're watching this on a computer right now, which uses ones or zeros. Quantum computers will be able to use ones and zeros at the same time. Have you ever wondered what is quantum physics and what is quantum computing? Regular computers that we have today use the ideas of classical physics. This is the set of ideas that describe how the everyday world works. The ideas of quantum physics describe how nature works at the tiniest length scales. At these tiny length scales, particles aren't just particles anymore. They're also waves at the same time. And there are some special things that allow computers to work a lot more efficiently. One of these things is the idea of a superposition. Most everyday objects are just in one state. Quantum objects can be in multiple states at the same time. Another interesting feature is the idea of entanglement. So this is where two particles can be correlated in a way that completely defies our everyday understanding. Everyday computers that we have make use of transistors. Sometimes we call these bits. They can be off or on. Sometimes we call it zero or one. The quantum version of the bit, the qubit we call it, this can be zero or one, but it can also be zero and one at the same time. If we have a computer made out of qubits, you can prepare the input to the computer in multiple states. You can get information on lots of different inputs with just one run of the computer. Likewise, if we have entangled qubits, if you do something to one qubit, it actually can affect the other qubit at the same time. So we know that quantum computers will be exponentially faster than classical computers for a certain set of problems. Simulating my favorite molecule, and perhaps your favorite molecule, caffeine, would take a number of transistors roughly equal to the number of silicon atoms in the entire planet Earth. If we had a quantum computer, we could do this on a single chip about the size of my fingernail with just 50 qubits. You could imagine simulating new kinds of materials with new functionality. Right now, the main market for quantum computers are governments and other scientists. Maybe someday there will be reasons for us to have quantum computers in our houses. We call the set of ideas of quantum physics quantum 1.0. This is ideas of superposition and entanglement. Quantum 2.0 is the idea that maybe we can use these ideas for useful technologies. We also know that we can create quantum networks. So these are systems that can transmit regular classical information from one place to another with complete security. They can also transmit quantum information, superposition or entanglement, from one place to another. Quantum physics also allows teleportation. It's real. It happens in labs here at the university and all across the world. Let me show you how this works. So I have two coins here. On one coin, I have a little piece of tape on the back, T for tails. I'm gonna stick these two coins together here, and I'm gonna flip it like this, all right? I have no idea right now if these coins are heads up or tails up. I'm gonna take these two coins apart. I've got one on my right hand and one on my left hand. So if we want to teleport an imaginary heads from my right hand to my left hand, the fact that this was a tails, it tells me that I need to flip the coin in my left hand, and I know that this will now be a heads. There it is, a heads. Every time I use this tape to stick them together, I make sure that they have the same orientation. So when I flip these two coins, I have no idea if it's heads or tails, but what I know is that the two coins are the same. And it's that correlation that's at the heart of entanglement, and that's what you use to teleport, in this case, a coin from my right hand to my left hand. In quantum teleportation, it's not just a heads or a tails, but superposition or entangled states. Someday we'd like to teleport cats or people, so you would find out the state of all of the atoms in your body, and then you would map it onto another collection of atoms somewhere else, and you would change that collection of atoms into the extended object. To be able to do that, we need to be able to interact with the individual quantum degrees of freedom of these extended objects. And that's just as hard as building a quantum computer. It takes a lot of qubits to make a quantum computer. So we're exploring ways to make this more efficient. The environments we work in are really controlled. They're really dark, typically. They're really cold. They have no air molecules. It's in a very high vacuum, typically. So it's a really clean environment for these quantum systems, these qubits, because we don't want the light, the sound, and the heat to disrupt these quantum devices. So we like to explore ways to make quantum devices more robust. If we can make them interact with light, maybe we can allow them to function in a broader range of environments. The next area we'd like to focus on is figuring out how we can create a quantum device for a positive societal impact. So we're really interested in collaborating with folks at the medical center to develop new kinds of quantum sensors for diagnostic or therapeutic research. While we haven't seen a major practical implication of a quantum computer just yet, I think we're probably not far away. Classical computers aren't going anywhere. One of the current themes of research is looking at quantum enhanced computing, where you merge both classical and quantum computers. This will be likely a very important thread of research in the near term. So if we continue doing this research on quantum physics and quantum computing, who knows what will happen?